month, Soviet President Mikhail Gorbachev attends a meeting in London of the seven major capitalist powers. Astonishing news a few years back, but no longer. These are remarkable times in the Soviet Union. And for two decades, 60 Minutes has been chronicling some of the changes taking place there. Along the way, we've come up with some fascinating images. Like top American military officers dancing with one of the Soviet's top officers in far-off Samarkand. Or the visit we paid to Perm 35, the last of the Soviet gulags.
Can eat this food.
We met a young Soviet reporter who had the guts to report the Soviets' brutal war in Afghanistan when the Soviet government wouldn't even admit there was a war going on. We heard from an 80-year-old woman, her life, her family's life, destroyed by Joseph Stalin. We reported on thousands of drunks drying out in police tanks in Moscow. And thousands of Soviet vacationers drying out on the beaches of Yalta. We got a chilling look at one of the cities left deserted in the wake of Chernobyl. And we went home to Moscow with Mstislav Rostropovich on his triumphant return from 16 years of exile. We'll share all that and more with you tonight in a special one-hour report on 60 Minutes.
I'm Mike Wallace.
I'm Morey Safer.
I'm Harry Reasoner.
I'm Ed Bradley.
I'm Steve Croft. Those stories and Andy Rooney tonight on 60 Minutes.
I have a confession. I have no idea how to choose a long-distance calling plan. I don't have to. Sprint does it for me. They keep track of when and where I call and actually let me know which calling plan will save me the most money. They do all that just because I'm a Sprint Priority customer. And I thought it was because I was their spokesperson.
People are taking better care of themselves and their money. That's why they're spending more time at McDonald's today. For food and prices that are right for the times. Served up with the kind of service that made McDonald's, McDonald's. It's all part of getting more for your money. That's McDonald's today. McDonald's, McDonald's
today. I drove that car last weekend.
The big Mercedes?
The S-Class.
What'd you think?
I think you have to sit in that big leather seat. Put Mozart, maybe Beethoven on the stereo. Then go out and drive in tight rush hour traffic, up some back mountain road, all night in a rainstorm. And then you'll know what I think.
Which is?
I think just maybe I drove the perfect car. Or as close to it as anybody's ever come.
Over the past 20 years, 60 Minutes has told the tale of some remarkable changes in the Soviet Union. None more stunning to us than back in 1989, in a time still considered to be the Cold War, when the chairman of the U.S. Joint Chiefs of Staff, Admiral William Crowe, was invited to the Soviet Union for serious talk and to inspect some of the Soviets' most sophisticated military equipment, much of it equipment seen before by Americans only on spy satellites. Well, Admiral Crowe and his Soviet hosts invited us to come along.
This is beyond my wildest expectations. Even when I thought it might come, I didn't think it would come during my tenure. In fact, in many senses, this is the most important official visit I have made in my military career.
The Admiral's official host for the trip, General Mikhail Moiseev.
Mike, have you met
head of the Soviet armed forces, part of a new generation of Soviet military leaders too young to have fought in World War II.
Galinin!
First stop on the tour of Soviet military sites, the Soviet Missile Forces Academy near Moscow, where officers learn how to fire strategic missiles like the SS-19, all 100 tons of it. Next to Kubinka Air Force Base near Moscow, where the Americans got a close-up look at and a chance to ask questions about some of the aircraft they trained to fight against. The highlight, a visit to the cockpit of a Soviet Blackjack fighter bomber, similar to the U.S.'s V-1. With glasnost now apparently sweeping the Soviet military, could there possibly be joint military exercises between the U.S. and the Soviets?
Joint maneuvers?
Совместные учения и маневры можно сделать.
Я это не исключаю.
I do not exclude that possibility.
Мы были во Второй мировой войне, были союзниками.
We were allies in the Second World War.
Победили фашизм.
We conquered fascism together.
Наши солдаты сражались с американскими солдатами.
Our soldiers fought side by side with US soldiers.
Allies again?
Снова союзники.
А вы это исключаете?
Do you exclude that possibility?
I'm asking questions.
Я просто задаю вопрос.
Нет, а я хочу...
А почему бы и нет?
Да, а я хочу просто тоже спросить. А вы это исключаете?
And I want to ask you a question in return. Can you exclude that possibility of being allies?
Absolutely not, sir.
From Moscow to 2 degrees north of the Arctic Circle, near one of the Soviets' major secret naval bases at Murmansk. That is the Kirov, a Soviet nuclear-powered missile cruiser. After first visiting a nuclear submarine, and only one other member of his party was allowed there, the chairman comes aboard the Kirov. No American officer has visited such a sophisticated Soviet ship before.
Честь вашего прибытия построен. Начальник караула, капитан-лейтенант Свигун.
Admiral Fry, you looked as though your heart was going to burst when you came aboard the Kirov. And as you came aboard, they were playing the Star Spangled Banner.
Very touching moment for me. I never thought I'd see that. I didn't expect it, and I was moved.
Здравствуйте!
Hello!
The Soviets' Northern Fleet also displayed its special entertainment unit.
Thanks for your hospitality. And best of everything to you. You have a proud and fine command.
But the most moving moment of his trip for the Admiral came in Volgograd, the city once known as Stalingrad, when he talked with some older citizens who had lived through the war. Promise, promise, there will be no more wars, she said. By the time the group had reached Samarkand, deep in Soviet Central Asia, 8 days into the trip, the awkwardness there had been at the beginning of the visit had simply melted away. That's Air Force Vice Chief Hatch. And that's Army Vice Chief Robert Ruskassy. And this man is Soviet Marshal Sergei Akhramayev, a key advisor to President Gorbachev. This is General Joe Wendt, Vice Chief of Staff of the U.S. Marine Corps. Last stop of the trip, the Kremlin.
How do you do, Mr. President? And I believe the very fact that you have visited the Soviet Union and visited military facilities and units also demonstrate that we are moving from the notion of the enemy to the notion of partners.
Admiral, is there something extraordinary going on between the Soviet Union and the United States right now?
I must be candid with you. I think there is. We are in a transition period, and it is too early for me to paint clearly where we're going. But we're going.
One of the unexpected places we were permitted to go was Chernobyl. Steve Croft went there in 1989 to report on the 1986 nuclear disaster, a disaster the Soviet officials had at first tried to cover up. When Croft went there, the scope of the destruction and its long-term effects were only just beginning to come to light.
The traffic through the Ukrainian countryside starts to thin out long before you get to Chernobyl. Out the window, villages that have survived Turks, Tartars, and Nazis stand undisturbed. Then slowly it begins to hit you. What's wrong with the picture? People. For mile after mile, there are no people. The toll, human and material, from what happened here in late April 1986 is still being assessed, and it is almost beyond comprehension. When a series of human errors during a test blew open reactor number 4, it sent a radioactive cloud 3 miles into the sky. But as the Soviet people are beginning to find out, it did not just blow away. It took battalions of the Red Army and 3,500 volunteers from all over the Soviet Union just to clear the radioactive debris from the roof of the reactor. Even wearing protective gear made of lead, each one was allowed to work for 1 minute. Then they left. That's right, 1 minute. Entire villages have been bulldozed, hosed down, and buried, except for Pripyat. It was one of the largest Soviet cities built in the 20th century. With luxurious, ultra-modern accommodations by Soviet standards, it was home for 45,000 atomic workers and their families. Today, Pripyat is a nuclear ghost town. The only sign of life is the music, piped in continuously to keep the decontamination crews that have to be here from going crazy. The people who lived in Pripyat weren't told that anything was wrong until 36 hours after the disaster. Then they were evacuated and have never returned. Perhaps the most startling and overlooked fact about Chernobyl is that 3 of its 4 nuclear reactors are still in full operation. In spite of pressure to shut them down, in spite of warnings from the scientific community that the basic design is unsafe. In fact, some of the worst areas of contamination extend far beyond Chernobyl, far beyond the Ukraine, into the Belarusian Republic, hundreds of miles from the reactor. There are more than 700 towns and villages under rigid controls, and new hotspots are still being discovered every day. Few aspects of daily life are untouched by the disaster. In Brogan, the entire food supply must be shipped in daily from other parts of the country. Even crates of milk carry specially certified seals, giving their origin and date of processing. The food grown locally is too radioactive for the people who live here to consume every day. Too valuable just to throw away. So it's scattered to other parts of the Soviet Union. On the theory that if some people eat radioactive food occasionally, it won't hurt them. The biggest impact will be on the next generation and on generations yet unborn. In some areas, children are served all 3 meals at their schools to cut down on their chances of being exposed to contaminated food. They're checked once a year for thyroid problems
10% have shown signs of some abnormality. Chernobyl will not only affect how long these children live, it will affect the way they live. At a school in Bragan, we found a biology field trip being conducted in a hallway in front of a man-made forest. Children are not allowed in the woods under any circumstances. It's where the radiation levels are the highest. Many of these students will grow up without ever having picked a mushroom or climbed a tree. Part of a grim reality that's just now sinking in. The Soviet people have begun asking themselves, are we ready for nuclear power? Is it worth it? They will be dealing with this one mistake for perhaps as long as man is on the planet. For somewhere, underneath all that steel and concrete, there's still a mass of plutonium, and it will be there, deadly, for the next 20,000 years.
Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Today!
Kellogg's Fun Pack. Choosing one is half the fun.
For 75 years, Mitsubishi Motors' diamond emblem has symbolized its unbending standard of quality. Introducing the highest expression of that standard, the Diamante, where meticulous design and craftsmanship lead to extraordinary comfort and driving pleasure. Diamante, the new luxury performance sedan from Mitsubishi. The word is getting around.
Here's the cash for your scuba lessons. You are going to spend this on souvenirs for the kids. But this punk has other plans for your vacation money. It's your vacation. Do something about it. Carry American Express traveler's checks.
This is the famous NutraSweet gumball, the first little product that introduced everyone to the great taste of NutraSweet. Well, then we started thinking, hey, this could be big. So we started talking to people. First to soft drink people, then cereal people and cookie people. We talked to dessert people and cocoa people and coffee people and cake people, breakfast people and tea people and yogurt people. Man, like, you'd be amazed how many food people there are to talk to. So you're probably saying, okay, you've been doing a lot of talking. Now how many foods do you have to show for it? NutraSweet, celebrating 10 years of making the world a better place to eat.
Can a man mix old friends with a new love?
Couldn't you just plot?
Norman Lear's Sunday Dinner.
A cream puff.
Well, I'd rather be a cream puff than a blob of sourdough.
Then,
all blood is the same. Commie propaganda pure and simple.
All in the Family is hot all over again.
You sure are shoveling it tonight, Archie.
It all starts after 60 minutes tonight.
I'm Paula Zahn.
And I'm Harry Smith. Times are tough, but you can survive and maybe even profit during a recession.
Tomorrow we'll tell you how on CBS This Morning.
Northern Exposure, Monday.
These days we hear nothing but disaster tales about the Soviet economy. Row after row of empty store shelves, endless lines for everything from food to flimsy footwear. Disintegration, collapse. But back in the spring of 1972, Morey Safer found himself in a Moscow that, as far as what was then available in the stores was concerned, Mikhail Gorbachev would be delighted to settle for today.
Moscow is shopping its way through a new consumer revolution. No longer do clothes and cars have to be drab and shoddy in order to prove their socialist worthiness. And all these shops are crammed full of very attractive goods from both sides of the Iron Curtain. That kitchen debate between Nikita Khrushchev and Richard Nixon, conducted more than a decade ago now, is all but irrelevant today.
There are no visible shortages. In the Moscow of 5 years ago, foreigners were offered cash on the spot for the clothes on their back. Today, imports from abroad are available everywhere. Food is expensive, but Russians are prepared to pay the price. And it's abundant. From Bulgaria, Romania, fruit from North Africa. From the Soviet Union, too, but the Russians still haven't found an efficient way of distributing it. So it's one area where capitalism still flourishes. Georgian farmers can get rich, bringing their produce to market in Moscow. But some things are cheap. Cigarettes and liquor. All kinds of entertainment. You get the feeling here that these people feel that all the sacrifices of the past have been worth it. Their government is responsive to their physical needs. And in purely urban necessities, the things we in the West were brought up to expect from our cities, Moscow is even more responsive. Freedom, well, communism neither offered it nor did it take it away. Dissent remains untolerated. Moscow's passive face may be one that many Americans might long for. Material prosperity combined with strict observance of the law.
Now, 6 years into glasnost, openness, it's difficult to remember just how closed the Soviet Union used to be before the Gorbachev era. In 1980, still in what we viewed as the bleak gray days of Leonid Brezhnev, Harry Reasoner traveled to Moscow for an inside look at Soviet television. Back then, that was considered a major journalistic coup, and Harry was surprised.
I don't know exactly what we expected to see, but it's not all gray and grim. There is a sugar coating of diversity around the service of the state. A spoof on American Westerns, for instance. Sometimes even a little sex creeps in. This is not the sex. This is the message. This pair is one of four teams on the daily showcase of Soviet television news. Vremya, a half-hour summary of what the Russians regard as all the news that's fit to broadcast, on in the primest of time every night. Vremya, which means time, and is labeled an information program, likes to begin with some upbeat domestic news. No crime or violence, but maybe an interminable pain of delight that the harvest is coming in. Almost every night we watched, there was a harvest story. The suspense was bearable. Then maybe a story about energy and how important it is. You can watch coal being carried from one place to another for 5 minutes. This has two effects, one intended. You realize the importance of energy, and you go to sleep. You have to remember this about Soviet journalism. They don't feel guilty that they use only news that is helpful to the state. They think instead Americans are crazy to let their journalists report discord and diversity, trivialities, and to them, pointless violence. Henrikas Deskevicius, a vice chairman of Soviet television who has wide acquaintance with Western broadcasting styles, explained.
Could a journalist in the Soviet Union expose a Watergate situation?
We don't have Watergate.
That makes things simpler if you have no problems. But you couldn't do it even if you did. You could not expose it.
It's a theoretical question. I am a practical man.
But then along came glasnost, and the Soviet press, with the encouragement of Gorbachev himself, became ever more daring. As Harry Reasoner found in 1989, when he went back to Moscow to profile a remarkable young Soviet journalist who had the gumption to report what was really happening in Afghanistan at a time when the Soviet government wouldn't even admit to its own people that the army was caught up there in a brutal war. That reporter, 20-year-old Artyom Borovik.
Last August, we went with Borovik to Moscow's Gorky Park, where thousands of veterans of that once secret war, all combat-hardened blue beret paratroopers, were gathering publicly for a reunion. To many of these men, Borovik is a hero. They hate Russian reporters because until he began writing about their combat experiences, the entire Soviet media was locked in a conspiracy with the government, not just to conceal atrocities, but to deny the basic fact that these soldiers were fighting and dying for their country.
What he says is that the press was playing a very bad role in Afghanistan. It didn't write truth.
At least 15,000 young Russians died in Afghanistan. But until a year ago, the Soviet government didn't acknowledge any deaths. And to this day, the Russian people still don't know what their soldiers did to the Afghans. Because of the Red Army's campaign of terror, 5 million Afghans, one of every three men, women, and children, fled their country. and an estimated million Afghans lay dead by the time the final Russian combat soldier withdrew last spring.
America went through all kinds of reports of American atrocities on the destruction of the village of My Lai and has now sort of put it behind. Can you do that?
Right now, put it behind? Yeah. No, we're on the eve of discovering our My Lais, what happened in Afghanistan. Some people will do everything to stop it, and some people will do anything to write about it. This is extremely important, because now the war might remain in the memory of people who live in this country as a good war. But if journalists and writers do their job, this war will remain in the memory of the country as something the future generations will be ashamed of.
Borovic's powerful portraits of young Russian soldiers fighting in a brutal war were potentially explosive. Not all the veterans like what Borovic is trying to do. And as the day wore on and the vets began to feel their vodka, a number of them started to threaten us physically and to accuse us of being Jews and Freemasons. They tried to stop our filming and questioned Borovic's patriotism to be speaking English to an American camera crew.
I mean, we're not doing anything fantastic, anything great. We're trying to be normal. Simply normal people, normal journalists. That's what a normal journalist should do in the States, no matter where he lives. In the States, in this country, fighting bureaucracy and fighting for truth.
Borovic today is editor-in-chief of Top Secret, a Soviet magazine that specializes in investigative reporting. After that candid view of the new Soviet press, Harry returned once again for a frank, bleak look at the sorriest state of Soviet women.
For every Soviet man on parade, you can bet there's a Soviet woman standing behind him. Or, more accurately, sweeping up behind him. Young or old, it doesn't matter. That's what women do in the Soviet Union. If this is equality, the equality Lenin gave them, it's not most women's idea of equality. It's not even a Russian woman's idea of equality. No one seems to know more about Soviet women than Elena Korinskaya. She wrote the book, literally wrote the book, and she was the first one we went to see.
Many American men are brought up to respect women. Here, women could be loved, but they would never have any respect.
And you don't have to look very hard to find exactly what she's talking about. A Soviet woman spends 4 hours a day standing in line. Find a line and you'll find an argument, usually about who was first in line. Except for vodka, men never queue up.
Which brings us to drink and Gorbachev's losing battle against alcoholism in his country. To get an inside look at that struggle, the Soviet police let Harry Reasoner ride along with them as they attempted to haul in any and all they found drunk.
The special squads patrol 24 hours a day. Their only duty to spot anyone who is unsteady on his feet. There are 12 sobering up stations in Moscow, utilitarian and unwelcoming. Sort of specialized police precinct stations just for drunks. To simplify things, the attendants help the drinkers to undress. A nurse and doctor are on duty if there's a problem, but this man is okay. He's just tired.
Запах алкоголя, зрачки расширены.
Each guest is registered for reference if he gets arrested again. And his employer and neighborhood policemen are informed of where he is and why. The station's got about 4.5 million guests a year.
Of course, the new spirit of openness has come to apply to tourists as well as to journalists, though not always with happy results. As Morey Safer found when he chronicled the travels, the travails, of a group of Western tourists through the buses and boredom and banquets of a visit to Yalta.
Speaking of which, the food at Yalta. It may not appeal to the palate, but it is also not a delight to the eye. But who cares when there's so much else to see? There is the promenade in Yalta, the daily stroll in which Soviet and foreign tourists easily mix. A pose, perhaps, with a photographer's dog. All very leisurely. Even more leisurely is the whole business of lining up without knowing what the payoff may be.
The line will never get through. What are they getting?
I don't know. A magical mystery queue. Or you can join the great potato line. And there's always shopping. Shopping without the misery of choice. Kmart, take note.
How much is that one?
20.
20 what? 20 rubles?
20 rubles?
For a t-shirt?
Forget it.
But hold on. Best is yet to come. For right at your front door is the gleaming Black Sea. A beach to make you forget Club Med or Saint-Tropez or Copacabana. Thin is definitely not in Yalta. Not a single anorexic Ken or Barbie doll to be found. It's refreshing to find a people who are not slaves to some designer's idea of how we should look. That's it, more or less, a taste of Yalta. So come on down. And if you've already been, y'all come back, you hear?
Oh, glad to be going home.
I know it was our imaginations, but it felt like people looked at us like we had come from Mars instead of just moving from out of state. Oh, for a friendly face. Thank goodness we bank at First Interstate.
And thank goodness for Bill.
These old-fashioned shingles have worn out before their time.
He also gave us the warm welcome we needed.
Now that's extra mile service.
If you want extra mile service, come to First Interstate Bank. We go the extra mile for you, guaranteed.
Fat free? I can't wait to taste this. What's it called? A bit of celery? Box of nothing? I'm sick of watching out for fat. To me, everything good has fat in it.
Now, you're not telling me these are fat free, because these are some delicious flakes.
Kellogg's Corn Flakes have always been fat free.
Fat free? Kellogg's Corn Flakes? We'll take the ribbon from my hair.
A good reason to taste them again for the first time.
60 Minutes, a CBS News weekly magazine, will continue.
In the past 2 years, one TV show has actually been credited with saving more than 50 lives. So if you think you can live without watching television for one night, make sure it isn't Tuesday.
The show is Rescue 911. The look is CBS.
This is CBS.
These old-fashioned shingles have worn out before their time. The culprit, insides of mere paper.
Now these are long-lasting Owens Corning shingles. They have a heart of pink fiberglass, so they shrug off moisture, keep their cool and baking sun, and stay stuck through even the toughest winter storms.
And that is no snow job.
For the Owens Corning supplier nearest you, call 1-800-222-ROOF.
What do we have here?
We have a new Olds Cutlass Sierra.
Oh, we do?
Yes, and with it we have front-wheel drive, room for six, power steering, AM-FM stereo.
Do we have money to pay for this?
Hey!
Oh, I suppose they gave you money just for buying the car.
$1,500 cash back.
With $1,500 cash back, a new Sierra never looked so good.
So good!
We can give you cash back, too. See your Peninsula Olds dealer.
I think we're on to something here.
Up the Michigan, someplace special.
Who thought we would ever be able to broadcast interviews with prisoners in a Soviet prison camp? Well, in 1989, we did just that. Another extraordinary example of Gorbachev's glasnost. Videotape shot by two French journalists. At Perm 35, the Soviet gulag 800 miles from Moscow, in a desolate region on the edge of Siberia. It is only one of a chain of labor camps, one of the most pleasant, we were told, that Joseph Stalin spread across that country. These images of barbed wire, electric fences, and watchtowers are the first ever recorded of a Russian prison camp. This one holds the last official political detainees in the USSR. During the 1970s, there were 270 political prisoners in Perm 35. Now their numbers have dwindled to 38. Colonel Nikolai Osin has been director of this camp for 17 years. The prisoners say he is sadistic and cunning. For the prisoners of Perm 35, the day was about to begin. There is a mix of prisoners. 11 are war criminals, collaborators with the German army or the Nazis during World War II. Now it is said these old men are informers to the prison authorities, and for this they get better food and jobs, like tending the garden in the camp. Five are accused spies, like Filatov, said to have been working for the CIA. He has been in the gulag for 10 years. And there are 22 political prisoners, many convicted simply for trying to leave the country. Vadim Arenberg, he tried to hijack a plane to Israel. Bogdan Klimchak escaped to Iran where the Shah's police returned him to the Soviets.
Get, eat, police. Food.
Leonid Laubman was an economist, convicted of treason. He has been here for 11 years. Volkov, named the Butcher, the most vicious guard in the camp. The crew insisted upon seeing three political prisoners held in a special section, shut off from the rest of the camp.
Политические взгляды, за мои политические убеждения, так как я по своим взглядам антикоммунист и антисоветчик. Две недели назад начальник лагеря мне сказал, Михайлов, в присутствии всех, что вот ему сказал, что Михайлов, если ты будешь дергаться, мы тебя отправим в сумасшедший дом. То есть тогда, когда у них уже принят закон о том, что якобы психиатрия не будет применяться как фактор подавления, репрессий, на самом деле это постоянно у них происходит.
There are fewer and fewer prisoners at Perm 35, and the ones who remain wait to see if they will be the next to be released. Since this film was shot, several have been permitted to leave. More will be liberated soon. Colonel Osin says they aren't expecting any more arrivals. By next year, he says, there won't be anyone left. The end of an era. The last gulag. Perm 35. When we last checked, Perm 35 was still open. We don't know how many prisoners are still held there. Despite this horrific past, these days there is increasing talk in the Soviet Union of the need for an iron hand, of a return to order, to discipline. There is even wistful talk of Joseph Stalin. During the quarter century he ruled, at least 20 million Soviet citizens died, victims of Stalin's bloody paranoia, victims of his mindless assault on any and all he perceived as in any way dangerous to him. In 1989, we reported on an unofficial Soviet group called Memorial, dedicated to publicizing the atrocities committed in the name of, at the direction of, Joseph Stalin. One of the members of that group, a remarkable Soviet woman, Galina Ivanovna Lewinson. She's 80 years old and lives alone in a small apartment in Moscow. Back in 1936, suddenly one night, her husband, a literary critic just out of university, was arrested. She never saw him again. Why was he arrested?
I don't know. He was executed. There was no crime, as most of those had no crimes at all. No crimes. Of course, some kind of a crime was written down, but there was no crime. There was no crime. That's it.
A year after her husband was executed, Galina herself was arrested, taken to the infamous Lubyanka prison. What was her crime? She was the wife of her husband.
Just a member of the family.
Guilt by association. Guilt because of being married to a man who had been arrested.
The women weren't killed, but were put in camp.
But that was only part of her family's tragedy. Well, 2 months after her arrest, her father was also imprisoned. Then her husband's brother was picked up.
Four of the family. Quite enough. For nothing. All of them were for nothing. Everyone. For nothing. Everyone. That's it. That's it.
It is to commemorate such tragedy that Memorial has been organizing public exhibits of the Stalin era over past months. Like this wall of memory, as it's called, papered with documents, photographs, official records, the only records of people arrested who never returned, all of whom disappeared in Stalin's Holocaust. Many come now with their own personal grief, half a century old, their friends and relatives consumed by Joseph Stalin. Princeton Professor Stephen Cohen is a CBS News consultant and an expert on the Stalin era.
When did this all become known to the Soviet citizen?
That is a painful question that's being debated here. People say, we didn't know. We didn't know.
The same thing that happened in Germany. When Hitler came. Hitler came. Many people said that we didn't see anything. Nothing happened. The same thing, exactly.
People worship Stalin as a kind of living god. It was bizarre. It's hard for us to even imagine it. It's hard for Soviet citizens today, I know hundreds of them, who lived through that, to remember and imagine and understand how they themselves paid homage to this cult. Stalin's grip on this society has not yet been broken. His legacy is everywhere here.
Many Soviets, viewing the current chaos and nationalist unrest under Gorbachev, look back almost longingly to the era of brutal order under Stalin. In a Moscow marketplace, we conducted our own informal public opinion poll. What do you remember of Joseph Stalin?
About Stalin. I remember all the best things about Stalin. I am simply delighted with him. I remember from my childhood that we could see how he cared about simple people, about our nation, about children.
Would you like Stalin back in the Soviet Union today?
Yes. I would like him back. If it was Stalin's time now, people wouldn't be standing about in the marketplace. Half of them would be in prison now. And everyone would work. As it is, there is no one but loafers here, speculators and loafers.
I'm a Soviet Army Lieutenant Colonel. I'm 37. What I think that Stalin is in the same boat with Hitler. He's one of the most terrible tyrants history has ever known. And I hate this man's guts. He murdered in cold blood tens of millions of people.
Okay, if that's true, then why do so many people that I'm talking to here say we need Stalin back?
Stalinism has very deep roots in
why?
These people.
Why?
Because this country has never had democratic traditions. You know, some time must pass before people realize what that freedom is more than a pound of sausage.
No Soviets know the value of freedom better than Mstislav Rostropovich, Slava, one of the world's finest cellists, and his wife Galia, Galina Vishnevskaya, who was one of the Soviet Union's top sopranos. In the 1970s, they stirred the wrath of the Kremlin by defending dissidents like Solzhenitsyn and Sakharov. And as a result, they were forced into exile for almost 16 years, condemned as enemies of the state. But then, in January 1990, Glasnost invited them back with their daughter Olga, and one of their first stops back in Moscow was the grave of dissident Andrei Sakharov. He had died a few months earlier.
My tears coming out from my eyes. I so admired him.
He admired him so much that back in 1974, when some members of the Bolshoi Theater came to Slava and Galina and told them that all they had to do was sign a mild public declaration against Sakharov, and that would be enough to restore the two of them to official favor, Galia and Slava refused.
Why did you not sign the denunciation of Sakharov? Why not?
That's, I have conscience, that's answer. I have conscience.
In 1974, Slava and Galia finally understood they could survive as artists only by leaving Russia, as have so many others. Slava's career thrived in the U.S. and Europe, but not Galia's. Though at one time, she was the top Soviet soprano, in the West, her career slowly crumbled. And now in the winter of 1990, she and Olga walk outside the Bolshoi near the stage door she used at her triumphant concerts. Two old friends ask her to come inside, but she refuses. There are too many bitter memories, she told us, of how her fellow musicians, to curry political favor for themselves, had publicly denounced her and Slava.
Galia, was it all worth it? Was it worth it?
What?
Yes.
My destiny.
And it could not be any other way.
Was it worth it? The 16 years, the exile, the coming home. Was it worth it to write the letter about Solzhenitsyn, not to denounce Sakharov?
Dear, I completely repeat all what I made, even if I have no possibility in my lifetime coming back.
Slava, nothing speaks more eloquently of the artist's struggle against the brutality of dictatorship than the Fifth Symphony of Dmitri Shostakovich, one of the greatest Russian composers of the century. His career, too, almost destroyed by the Kremlin. You should play this music, Slava told his orchestra that night, so it feels like a fork in the brain.
Dodge Spirit, the Plymouth Acclaim. Last year, in consumer comparisons, 83 out of 100 people preferred the Acclaim and Spirit to Honda Accord. Both have a longer powertrain warranty than Honda, more interior room, and a driver's airbag. So what are you waiting for? A deal? All right. We're offering savings and incentives up to $2,250. Rediscover the great American family car values.
Sweet, celebrating 10 years of making the world a better place to eat.
Hey, Jerry, what's so good?
Well, it's nothing, honey. What?
Answer your mother.
I said it's nothing, honey. What?
That nothing, honey taste is always a hit.
Hey, Jerry, what's so good?
Kellogg's Nothing Honey Crunch.
What?
If you don't have AT&T 800 service, and trouble hits, who knows how long you could be out? Only AT&T automatically protects you through the 800 assurance policy. With AT&T, you would be guaranteed back in touch in 30 minutes or less. With anyone else, who knows? But if you do have AT&T, your 800 service is guaranteed. That's not all. Since AT&T connects calls 25% faster and has the fewest blocked calls, more 800 calls get through, so you can make more sales. With all that, why choose any other 800 service? Better service, better results. Another AT&T advantage. Call now for free installation.
The Soviet Union is in deep financial trouble, and the United States isn't in such good shape either. If the two of them had listened to Andy Rooney 5 years ago, both would be sitting pretty today.
The United States and the Soviet Union are having peace talks in Geneva, Switzerland. We don't know what they're talking about, but they say they're talking. I have a proposal. I'd like to see them issue a joint statement that would read like this. We, the representatives of the people of the United States and the Soviet Union, being of sound mind, do hereby suspend all military expenditures for 1 year. It's agreed that whereas we already have enough weapons to kill everyone in the world, we don't need any more. Between us, we spend $500 billion a year on arms. Because there's so much that needs to be done in the world, we agree to spend that same amount on things that'll do some good for a change. This is our budget. To clean up toxic waste dumps, $75 billion. To clean up the lakes, rivers, and oceans we've ruined, $50 billion. For education of every kind, for schools, for colleges, and for the education of more teachers, more scientists, more ordinary people, $100 billion. For highway and road repair, $100 billion. That's our highways, their roads. For the poor and hungry of the world, $25 billion. The money will be spent not to feed them, but to help them find ways they can feed themselves. On new and old libraries, $25 billion. On museums, $15 billion. On medical research to find a cure for cancer, perhaps, $20 billion. To bail out the farmers in both the United States and Russia, who seem to be in such sad shape, $10 billion. For joint space research, so we can find out whether what's out there is any good for us here on Earth, $75 billion. In the event the people of our two countries don't agree that this is a better way to spend $500 billion than on weapons, with $500 billion, we could give every man, woman, and child alive on Earth $100 to have a good time with. That includes all 1 billion Chinese. You'll notice this figure only comes to $495 billion. Because we all know how things work in the world, we've allowed $5 billion for graft and corruption. That's my Geneva peace plan.
I'm Mike Wallace. We'll be back next week with another edition of 60 Minutes.
Dodge Shadow America and Plymouth Sundance America not only have a more powerful engine and more room than the Honda Civic, they're the lowest priced cars in the world with an airbag. And now, there's a low monthly price for first-time buyers and additional factory-to-dealer incentives that could save you even more. At about $4.50 a day, that's less than you spend on lunch. Maybe it's time you rediscovered American values you can really sink your teeth into.
Every business morning, while the rest of the world is getting up, UPS is guaranteeing overnight delivery before 10:30 for far less than other companies charge. And every business morning, more people are waking up to that fact.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Warm memories become a recipe for fireworks and laughter next on Sunday Dinner. Then, will Archie get needled into giving blood on All in the Family? Later, horseplay gets deadly on Murder, She Wrote. And Sharon Gless faces the death penalty on an all-new Trials of Rosie O'Neill. All tonight on CBS. On America. This mother didn't want her baby girl. The child welfare system said keep her.
She denied the pregnancy, had the baby, abandoned the baby. Then the baby was returned to her.
So she kept the baby and killed her. When the child welfare system fails, on the CBS Evening News tomorrow.
Two horse breeders in a bitter feud. Did one help the other kick the bucket?
This is one tip that came straight from the horse's mouth.
On Murder, She Wrote, tonight. Major League Baseball and CBS present America at its best. Win an all-expense-paid trip to the 92 All-Star Game, plus $5,000 cash and more. Look for details in this special Major League Baseball CBS insert in selected June 23rd Sunday newspapers. And watch Major League Baseball on CBS.
This is CBS.